The J price point is unlike any manufacturer out there. We're really trying to build some quality. You can see that with the materials that we're using. We start with the frame. The frame is the foundation. It really doesn't matter how you build a trailer from here on up. If the frame isn't done properly, you're going to have a poor performing coach in the long run. Everything looks good new, and everybody knows everything looks good. You can dress up the cheapest piece of crap, put it in the show, and put all the doilies on the dinettes and have it look perfect. I want to see the coach after it's been hauled up in Alaska and Halifax and down to Orlando and back and hit all the chuck holes, and does the slide out still work? The reason why we can offer a 2-year warranty with the J-plate is we have a structuralizing frame. This is far more expensive than what the other guys are using, a welded frame. Structural I-beam framing, this is one piece extrusion. So the center beam here is one piece extruded. We also use a larger frame. For example, on a 30-footer, we use 8-inch, the competition is 6-inch. And there's a welded frame rather than a structural frame. And then where we use a 6-inch, they use a 4-inch. Also, the outrigger. The frame does not hold up the wall. The outrigger holds up the wall. The wall is here. The wall is out here. So the frame supports the outrigger. The outrigger supports the wall. Our outriggers are, we try to put them never more than 4 feet apart. Sometimes they're only 2-3 feet apart. And they're larger and closer together. So obviously you're going to have more support for that sidewall, and especially with the big slide-out models. Another thing we do is the structural cross members. That's what ties the entire perimeter frame together. If you notice here, the structural cross members, again, are never more than 4 feet apart. Where we've seen competitors put them 6 to 8 feet apart. Even the A-frame over here does not change all the way up to the regular Eagle trailer down to the J-flight. But what I've got here is an A-frame that's fully on rail. I've got a Hornet and a Springdale. They just showed up down there. I don't know how they got here. But if you can see, almost all of the competitive units, they tack weld the A-frame to the bottom, so there's only 2 weld points. And that's at the bottom of the frame, where you have tremendous torque and twist in the hitch area. Here we integrate it right into the frame, weld it, put additional gussets, weld those to the perimeter frame. So there's no stronger frame application than what we're using, even in our J-flight series. So it's the proper foundation for the coach. A good place to show this, if you've got a slide out, it's a great place to go around. Mom usually doesn't care. I want to go inside and take a look at the decor color, and that frame doesn't mean anything. Oh, so if the slide out doesn't work for years from now, you're not concerned, right? He's not going to catch hell, right? Oh, he is. Well, let me take that for a minute. Maybe we'll go over to the slide out area. And you can see the structural I-beam frame and, you know, the outriggers. They're just about to the tires and the slide out system. That's a good way to feature benefit that product. Yes, sir.
The only thing you don't want to do is show somebody one that came from Indiana to Pennsylvania in the wintertime.
Well, that's, I'm glad you brought that up. These are powder coated. Over here is the floor station. What we're starting off with is your 2x3s. Your 2x3s are 16 inch up center. We're going to do something that very, very, very few manufacturers do, even in their high-end product. If you look at a Montana, it's stapled USB. We're going to take 5/8 inch plywood, glued, screwed, nailed, and bolted. It's everything except tattooed. So they're going to drop glue on all of the 2x3s before this layer goes down. And they give them a 5/8 inch tongue and groove. And we really sell the plywood hard because, you know, the roof structure, we're going to go over that, and underneath the dinettes and underneath the bunks and the main bed and everything else. But once we get the plywood on, and again, the screws bolted, nailed, stapled, we're going to invert that, and then we're going to do our heat plenum, which we build in-house as well. The heat plenum, we're going to run right down the middle of the floor joist so you have direct access. We're not going to bend it or torque it at all. Now you're going to get the most efficient heat possible. And then we're going to cover it with insulation and polypropylene. It's superior to what we used to use Darko. Darko is a shiny material. The downfall of Darko, if you ever got any moisture in the belly for any reason, it would not weep back out. This does allow it to weep back out. But it does have 7 times the strength of galvanized steel or aluminum, the same thickness. So it's extremely strong. We wrap it around the floor. And then that's going to act as the moisture weather barrier
for the forces.
Coming here where we're going to invert the frame. In doing this, you're going to use your imagination a little bit. We've got galvanized steel wheel wells, but we're going to drop twin 40-gallon freshwater tanks in a J-flight. And I'm talking right down to a 22FB. Every single flight has got 80 gallons of fresh water, plus 6 gallons in the hot water heater. You got 86 gallons
it's J-flight.
Available for capacity. So dry dock camping or anything like that, nobody in this price range is going to do that. So you don't got to bother with hauling it around, filling it back up again, getting back to your campsite. We're taking that hassle out of it by dropping in 2 40-gallon. And again, that is J-flight. That's not Swift or that's a SLX would be, you know, tip over. Anyway.
And the frame on the SLX.
The 80 gallons of fresh is big. Right in here. Yep. Also, what we're going to do here, have you these extra axles, and then we're going to have the figure still about to read the tire. Which again is coming right back to the quality by using the structural IV frame, the plywood, the galvanized steel wheel wells. Extra axles, you're still about the radio tires. Everything is a higher quality. There's nothing that we cannot buy cheaper. Absolutely nothing that we cannot buy cheaper, right down to the screws that we use to build this coach. If we don't believe in it, we're not going to put it in. We'll study. What that's going to do is take the torque and twist away from the end of the slide. Then we run a 2x6 up to support the end of the slide. And once you've got that corner there, and a lot of the product you can go with, it's used product. And some of the competitors end it because of cost right at the slide. You'll see a lot of metal on used stuff that's been completely torn or cracked. But again, you get a lot of torque and twist. When you run it past the slide up room and then tie it in to all the framing, you're going to resist all of that. Got a lot of guys that chose, is this aluminum frame? And I don't say no, I say why do you ask? I don't know what his objective is. He's got something that he's thinking about. And if I just say no, I'm not getting there. So, you know, why do you ask? And then the guy will go right to, well, strength. Well, excuse me, sir, but when you, like, for example, vacuum bond on the sidewall, the studs are 6 to 8 feet on center. These are 16 inch on center. They don't have the headers above the windows. Matter of fact, the windows usually aren't framed at all. They're a compression fit window. The slide outs don't have the massive headers as well. So actually, structurally, strength-wise, your wood wall is a stronger wall. Then they'll start talking about weight. Well, oh man, that other one, that wood cushion weighs a ton more. It's 200 pounds average on a 30-footer. I weigh 200 pounds. So if I jump in your pickup, can you not pull the aluminum frame trailer? Okay, I weigh 213, so what? I had a couple of beers. Don't give me that look. Here, let me suck it in. Anyways, when you're looking at it, it's a non-issue. The weight issue is a non-issue. Then you start talking about damage. I worked for Holly Rambler for 10 years. They've always been aluminum frame. And then I'm 17 years here. It's not whether it's aluminum frame or wood frame. It's how well it's built. If you got a leaker, you got problems. I mean, we were tearing stuff apart at Holly Rambler, the ceiling paneling, all the insulation, all the wallboard, all everything was shot. And it's all aluminum frame. Repairability, this is easier to repair than aluminum stud wall. So sometimes you can take that guy that thought he was dead set on having aluminum frame and drop him right back into a J-flight. Because once you qualified him, if that's his only objection, I think we can handle that by maybe digging and getting a few of the questions out of the table.
Once you've got the sidewalls on in the front rear of the coach, basically we're going to drop the ceiling paneling in, and then we're going to go to our wood rafters. Believe it or not, you even got manufacturers now using OSB rafters, chipboard rafters. There's nothing that we cannot buy cheaper. Nothing. So right here, these are solid wood. We've got a 4.5-inch crown to them. And we're going to put them 16 inch on center for greater strength. Then we're going to start putting some components in like air conditioning ducts. The air conditioning duct here is, first of all, it's polystyrene. I call it a double insulated duct because, first of all, this is an insulator, a polystyrene. Then we're gonna slip it right through all the roof trusses, and then we're gonna cover it with another layer of insulation. So it's double insulated. Now, if it's the full foil package, you would then have the ester foil on top of that. Even with the thermal package, you get the ester foil on top of that. But that'll bring it to R22. Because you got the 7 and 15. Because even if you put it on the belly, the thermal pack option, you are getting the ester foil on the roof truss. We're gonna run all the wiring, run the vent pipes up. And then we're gonna do something that basically no one else does. We're gonna throw plywood up instead of chipboard. And then we're gonna screw it down every 6 inches approximately. Sidewalls in the front and rear, the roof goes on. Then you got the guy with the adhesive and he's gonna spray it on. Then the worst job in the world, whoever made it doesn't like that leak. He gets to hand cut and fit the insulation and glue it between the studs. So it's the best way to insulate a coach. A lot more expensive, but
right, you know, 27 years ago, that's what I did.
Did you?
Yes, I did.
So someone didn't like
somebody
you back then?
Didn't like me.
Now, if you got the full foil pack that we talked about, the astrofoil would then go on the sidewalls. No, you'd already have it in the underbelly and the roof, and you put it on the front and the back as well.
And that will go on top of correct insulation.
So it's so thin, the compression is
minimum, just
we're also using the aluminum skin. I don't know, it's 24 thousandths. All that skin comes in smooth. We put our own crimp style on it. The reason why we prefer to crimp our own metal is we want a very small crimp style. It's 24 thousandths. Please don't say gauge. The higher you go, gauge, the thinner it is. 24 thousandths is a thicker metal. The one thing why we use it is that all these openings, the windows, the baggage doors, the empty doors, all those openings have to be sealed properly. When you have a smaller crimp style, it's very easy to get the proper seal so you don't have a leaker. So that's why we like the smaller crimp style.